Lamentations chapter 3. Let us go down to verse 18. And I said, my strength and my hope is perished from the Lord. Remembering mine affliction and my misery, the wormwood and the gall, my soul had them still in remembrance, and is humbled in me. This I recall to my mind, therefore I have hope. Amen. It is of the Lord's mercies that we are not consumed, because of his compassion fail not. They are new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness. Making it through the dark. Making it through the dark. Let us pray. Come, Holy Spirit, speak to us and through us. And let the words of my mouth and meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Amen. There are times in our lives when all seems dark. Times when there is no light to be found. Difficult days. Difficult dark days. Empty dark nights. When trouble and tragedy seem to confront us on every turn. Conquer one situation, only to be faced with another. Times when we just can't seem to get a break. Dark, scary times of what's going to happen next. Book of Lamentations is filled with tears and sorrow. One preacher referred to it as a poem of pity, a proverb of pathos, a hymn of heartbreak, a psalm of sadness, a symphony of sorrow, a story of shifting, a tale of tears, a dirge of desolation, a tragedy of travail, an account of agony, and a book of the boo-boos. In fact, some of it call it the wailing wall of the Bible. B.B. King has never sung or said a song than that which is contained in the Book of Lamentations. These five chapters are a series of dirges or funeral hymns in which the writer describes and laments over the desolation of Judah and the destruction of Jerusalem by the Babylonians in 586 BC. In other words, Lamentations is the writer's response to Judah's chastening by the hand of God. Now, I don't know anyone who ever enjoyed getting a whipping. Whether it was a whipping from your parents or spiritual chastening by God. But in fact, the scripture tells us in Proverbs, my son, despise not the chastening of the Lord, whether neither be weary of his correction, for whom the Lord loveth, he correcteth, even as a father the son whom he delighteth. And while I understand and realize that the stripe from our whipping is for our own good, at least that's what my daddy told me. When he said, son, this is going to hurt you more than it hurt me. I still don't quite get that one. Yet I think it's safe to say that nobody in here enjoys the pain and bruises that a whipping can cause. Well, that's what's taking place in our text today. Judah and its capital, Jerusalem, had suffered a spanking under the hands of God and had fallen to the Babylonian army under Nebuchadnezzar. The city and those left alive are in a crisis and the siege has taken its toll. The survivors are desperate for food, for their fortunes, and for their futures. They look around, but no help came from their allies. In fact, God has caused their former allies to turn against them in her hour of need. The kingdom and the city, once a queen among the nations, is now a hopeless widow. The thing that hurts the writer of Lamentations the most is the realization that this chastening could have been avoided and that it's their own fault. Yeah. See, here in Deuteronomy chapter 11, God offers Israel a choice. Yes, sir. Either a life of productivity and the enjoyment made possible by obedience to him, or a life of difficulty and opposition made necessary by disobedience. Yeah. Unfortunately, over and over again, they choose the latter. And as a result of Judah's sin, they have lost the peace, happiness, and hope that they once enjoyed. Some of you may be feeling that way today. You've lost your peace, happiness, and hope. I don't know about you, but I'm so glad. Trouble don't last always. In our text this morning are the words of comfort to God's people when we are in trouble and distress. And this is good news because somebody needs to know that, yes, we will face tragedy in our lives. But in the midst of our affliction shines a ray of hope. Yes. So let us examine our text. We need to point out that while the author of our text is not revealed, it is believed that this is the weeping prophet Jeremiah speaking. Yes. And I said, scripture reads, my strength and my hope is perished from the Lord. And I said, look who's talking. I'm a firm believer that we make our situation worse the moment we start complaining. Yes. Most of the time when we are complaining, we don't realize what we are saying is, I don't have a clue. Verse 18, now it's one thing to say, and I said, my strength and my hope is perished. However, it's another thing to say, my strength and my hope from the Lord is perished. Yeah. Notice he said, I said. In other words, this is a settled conviction. He is firm, his mind is made up, like a parent who tells his child, I said, go to your room. There's no argument there, there's no back talk. I don't want to hear what you have to say. My mind is made up. I said, this conviction points directly to the fact that his faith was not just slightly shaken, but had wholeheartedly failed. He goes on to say, my strength. In Hebrew, it's netza, which means future. The word carries with it the idea of a faint light at the end of a distant tunnel. You know, it's one thing to be broke and hungry, and know that payday is tomorrow. But it's another thing to be broke and hungry, and you realize that you do not have a job. Some who find themselves in that situation might say, my strength, my future is dead. However, the question is, how did it get this way? Well, right here in our text, we already discovered that Jeremiah had lost his strength, his hope for the future. The light at the end of the tunnel had gone out.
Yes.
But why? Notice verse 18 again, it says, and my hope. You know, it's quite interesting when you look at the actual definition of the word hope. In the Hebrew, it's toheleth, which means expectation. It is derived from the root yasha, which means to wait or to be patient, to cause, to have, or to make, to have hope, to stay, to tarry, to trust, to be in pain. So in essence, Jeremiah had given up his expectation of God's ability to help him. In other words, all hope was lost because he believed God had withdrawn and reneged and took back his strength. And now he is in essence saying, I'm tired of waiting. I'm tired of being patient. I'm tired of this pain. I'm tired of staying because nothing seems to change. I'm tired of trusting because I don't see any evidence that things are going to get any better. So don't tell me to tarry. You tarry. I quit. What we have here is a struggle between belief, unbelief, and faith. You see, on one hand, Jeremiah rightly attributes God as the source of his strength and hope. However, on the other, he's persuaded that God has forsaken him. So he makes up his mind and he says that I said, my strength and my hope is perishing from the Lord. And what brought Jeremiah to this conclusion? Well, I'm glad you asked me. Because it's right here in this text. You see, the whole thing started in his mind. In verse 19, he says, remembering my affliction and my misery, the wormwood and the gall. You know, sometimes you can't see the forest for the trees. We can be so caught up in remembering the past that we lose all hope for the future. And if we're not careful, we will remember our way right out of our blessing. In its proper context, the writer is referring to Jerusalem's station of destitution, hostility, and bitterness, in which he has lost all hope because he remembers his affliction and his misery, the wormwood and the gall. So he finds it difficult to be diverted from his sober frame of mind. In essence, Jeremiah is trying to justify, or should I say he's making excuses as to why he lost hope in God. He blames his lack of faith on his extreme circumstances and the fact that he is so pressed down by his affliction. However, we should not read the text and try to criticize Jeremiah or think it's strange that he has responded this way, because as believers, we are not excluded from trials and despair. Well, besides, we have failed from far less affliction. For some of us, the slightest change in the wind will cause us to fall on our knees and cry out to God, woe is me. We will even complain at the mere forecast of a chance of rain. Amen. Amen. Verse 20 says, my soul hath them still in remembrance and is humbled in me. Humble. The Hebrew word means to be bowed down, to be cast down. It refers to despair of one's soul. It refers to despair of one's life that is broken within, or one's life that has sunk to the ground in utter hopelessness. It's interesting how something can move from the mind to the soul. It's just one thing to have a nasty taste in your mouth about somebody or something. Yeah, that's bad enough. It's one thing when you detest or despise someone or something. That's even worse. But it's another thing when that pain has consumed you. And now it's deep and starting to overwhelm your innermost being. So you can understand what he's feeling when he says, oh, the misery this thing has caused. Oh, the gall, the deep-seated bitterness that this thing has caused in my life. Lord, help! This situation has got a hold of me.
Yes.
What we see here is the conduct of a person in deep anguish. In fact, this is an excellent word picture of what happens when the soul is convicted and humbles itself. It is as if the soul goes into some secret place and says, shh. And once it's quiet, then he gives himself over to moaning and tears, and then he bows himself before God. And it is as if the soul says, this mortal man has tried everything. I'm taking over now. The soul says, I'm in control. I got this. I'll take it from here. It is as if the soul is saying, I have to do something. This mortal man's decision will affect my future destination. And if I don't act, I'm going to end up in the pit with him.
Yes.
So here's what we're going to do. I'm going to humble myself, which in turn will cause him to humble himself in complete submission to God and to lie in the very dust of despair. I like this right here. The text tells us that the soul is humble. In other words, something on the inside got a hold of him.
Yes.
Y'all don't hear me.
Yes.
Something on the inside brought about a change of mind.
Yes.
You see, Jeremiah wanted to quit. He wanted to throw in the towel and say, take this job and shove it.
Yes.
But something on the inside caused him to say, but his word was in my heart as a burning fire shut up in my bones. I was weary with forbearing, and I could not say. You see, something on the inside had reminded him that his battle belongs to the Lord. He could lift up his eyes unto the hills from where it's coming his help. His help is coming from the Lord who made heaven and earth. He realizes that no weapon formed against him will prosper. He understands that deeply will endure for the night, but joy still comes in the morning. He is about to ascend from the pit to the pinnacle, and the mind that once caused him to doubt now reminds him that he can make it through the dark. Some of you may be feeling like Jeremiah this morning, ready to throw in the towel and declare that all hope is lost. But let me encourage you. Don't give up the fight. You see, God is able to do exceedingly, abundantly, above all that we ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us. David said, I've been young, now I'm old. Yet I have not seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed begging bread. Paul declares, we are more than conquerors through him that loveth. I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor power, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God. Even when all hope seems lost, it's God's opportunity. Something on the inside got a hold of Jeremiah, and he started to remember, and a striking miracle is about to take place in his thinking. In his loneliness, Jeremiah reviewed his experiences, and he began to reevaluate his situation, and this brought a feeling that hope just might be on the horizon. At that very moment, when we're at our lowest, well, it just might be a good time for us to renew our minds by remembering that God has never failed us. So why should he start now? Verse 21 says, this I recall to my mind, therefore I have hope. Notice he says, I recall. The word this helps us to understand that he is still wrestling with some things in his mind. In verse 18, he remembered his affliction, which caused him to lose hope. And now in verse 21, he recalls something that caused him to have hope. We have a tug of war of the mind right now. The word recall is a Hebrew word, which means to return. Well, what's he returning to? Notice in verse 21, he says, this I recall. Well, that just leads me to a second question. What is this that he recalled? John Calvin says, the word this refers to the infirmities, the misery, and the gall, which Jeremiah described in verse 18. The idea here is that his very weakness caused him to return to God. In his weakness, he finds hope that God will step in and supply the strength that he needs. Yeah. This, brothers and sisters, is a word picture again. The same picture we get when we look at the text of the prodigal son, who after he had blown all his inheritance, found himself eating slop that he fed to the pigs. The scripture says, and when he came to himself, which simply means that he recalled and remembered how good he had it in his father's house. And so he returned home. Here's what I'd like to call the grace of the text. Verse 22, it is the Lord's mercy that we are not consumed. Because of his compassion, they fail not. We will get to the compassion part, but let's deal with the mercy right now. The Hebrew noun is hesed, which is translated loving kindness. It appears over 30 times in the Old Testament. It is a very expressive word that conveys the idea of love, grace, mercy, faithfulness, goodness, and devotion. God's grace is defined as the unmerited favor of God towards sinners. Perhaps somebody here this morning needs to understand that the same grace is still available today. We simply need to remember that it is God's grace that saved us. Only his grace could have reached down and picked us up out of our lost and doomed condition. Ephesians says, for by grace ye are saved through faith. And not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, lest anyone should boast. And brothers and sisters, we can't talk about grace without talking about compassion. The word here in Hebrew is rahum, which literally means the womb. It means to be moved in the heart out of love for another. The word picture of grace of God actively moving in the life of the believer. Yes. You see, compassion is an action word. Contrary to popular belief, it is more than pity or sympathy because it causes one to get up and do something. Yes. The Bible says he was moved of Jesus. He was moved with compassion. And as a result, he healed the sick. He fed the hungry. Yes. He cast out demons. He died on the old rugged cross for you and for me.
Yeah.
Notice in our text, verse 22 and 23, that Jeremiah points out two things concerning the mercies and compassions of God. Verse 22, it says, they fail not. This verse speaks directly about God's immutability, which simply means God cannot change. He cannot get better. He's as good as he gets. He can't get worse. In fact, God says in Malachi chapter 3, for I am the Lord, I change not. And it's good to know that God never fails to be compassionate. Isn't it wonderful to know that God's judgment never comes until every means of grace has been exhausted? Now that's compassion. And then verse 23 says, they are new every morning. It seems that God is looking for some way to demonstrate his love for us each new day. Not only did we have the mercies and compassions of God when we're saved, but we have them now. And they're new every morning. Every morning we have fresh insistence of God's compassion toward us. He gives us the life and the air that we breathe. He's supplies the earth with sunshine and the rain it needs to produce food for us to eat. He paints a beautiful sunrise and sunset across the sky for our enjoyment. He smiles upon us each day with more blessings than we could possibly think of or imagine. This verse simply means that his loving kindness and compassion can never be exhausted. We wake up every morning to find new resources to encourage us on our way. Our Father loves us so much that he doesn't want us to have old stale mercies, living from door to day. I thank God that because today is a new day, I'll never see April 8th, 2018 again in my life. And what we face today is not the same thing we faced on yesterday or what we'll face on tomorrow. Each day has its own trials. Each day has its own difficulties. That's unique to us on that day. And our Father knows that. So he gives us new, fresh mercies and compassions. Just what we need for the day. Great is thy faithfulness. The word faithfulness means firmness, fidelity, steadiness, steadfastness. The word pictures God as one upon whom we can depend. Philippians tells us he is faithful to finish the good work he has started in you. He is faithful, Hebrews says, to chasten us when we're wrong. For whom the Lord loveth, he chastens and scourgeth with every son whom he receives. 1 John tells us he's faithful to forgive us when we confess our sins. It's amazing how God loves us. His faith to sympathize with us when we have burdens and problems. Hebrews tells us, for we don't have a high priest which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but at all points tempted like we are, and yet without sin. Great is his faithfulness. He is faithful to deliver when we cry out for help in a time of temptation. 1 Corinthians says, there have no temptation taken you, but such as common to man, but God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that ye are able, but will with the temptation also make a way to escape, that you will be able to bear it. He is faithful to save a lost sinner like you and like me. 1 Timothy says, this is the faithful saying, and worthy of all acceptance, that Christ came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am chief. I tell you, great is his faithfulness. Yes, we can commit our lives and souls into the hands of a faithful Creator who knows that he will always be faithful. In times of trouble, we need to imitate Jeremiah, who looked away from ourselves and looked to the Lord and wait on the Lord in patience and faith. Too often we look at our problems and we ourselves become so discouraged that we quit. Instead, we must look unto Jesus and let him see us through our troubles. When your heart becomes overwhelmed by the circumstances of life and you feel that God has deserted you, you remember his mercies, his compassion, his faithfulness will help you and to have hope in the midst of any storm. In that we can be sure that as we face the storms, the trials, and the valleys of life, God will always prove himself to be steadfast and faithful to you and to me. Simply put it, God is saying you can the dark times.
Yes.
You can count on me to guide you in the midst of the darkness.
Yes.
Somebody needs to know and be confident in the fact that the Lord will give you the necessary strength to face your trying times.
Yes.
I need to let somebody know that you'll never face a situation as a believer that God will not give you grace to help you make it through the dark times.
Yes.
Each day comes with new opportunities to get it right.
That's right.
What I messed up on yesterday, I got a brand new day to get right.
Yes.
Each day brings new opportunities for me to tell them, thank you, Lord,
yes,
for saving a wretch like me.
Yes.
New opportunities to tell them, thank you, Lord,
right,
for shining a light on my dark situation.
Yes.
When I couldn't see my way through,
yes,
when I thought there was no way out,
yeah,
he showed me mercy and compassion, stepped in and saved me. And that is why I know I can make my way through the dark. Why? Because great is his faithfulness. He is faithful even to the cross to die for you and for me. Isaiah says he's despised and rejected, a man of sorrow, acquainted with grief, and we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he has borne our grief, and carried our sorrows. Yet we did esteem him smitten, bitten of God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. And with his stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way.
Yeah.
But the Lord has laid on him the iniquities of us all.
Yeah.
He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He has brought as a lamb to the slaughter,
right,
as a sheep before the shearers is dumb. So he was opened not his mouth. He was taken from prison and from judgment. Who shall declare his generation? For he was cut out of the land of the living. For the transgression of my people he was stricken. Simply put, he died.
Yeah.
I'm so glad. Trouble don't last always. Because early Sunday, he got up with all power in his hand. If you don't remember anything else I said today, remember, God is faithful.
Yes,
just as every new day brings with its own set of burdens and problems, so each day brings a new, unfailing, all-sufficient supply of God's marvelous, matchless, wonderful grace.
Yes.
Brothers and sisters, I will remind you that God knows where you are in your life today, and you can make it through the dark.
Yes.
You remember that first resurrection moment. The women made their way through the dark to the home, through the dark to the tomb. Hope lost, despairing, saddened, heartbroken.
Yes.
Filled with the pain of grief and loss.
Uh-huh.
But they pressed their way through the dark.
Yes, Lord.
And what they discovered illuminated their darkness, renewed their hope, gave joy to their sadness, and has reverberated through the ages. You too can make it through the dark.
Yes. Yes.
Darkness comes in every life.
Uh-huh.
If you're not in darkness now, hang around just a little while.
Right.
Darkness is around the corner.
Yes.
When you think you ought to be walking in the sunshine, all of a sudden things get real dark.
Yes.
Darkness comes, and sometimes we get afraid. Darkness comes, and sometimes we want to throw in the towel.
Yes.
Darkness comes, and sometimes we want to give up. But don't give up. You can make your way through the darkness.
Yeah.
And I promise you, if you keep on pressing, keep on pushing, that on the other side of darkness is is a bright new morning. Yes. On the other side of darkness is a resurrection for your problems. Yes. On the other side of darkness is victory for your despair. I'm so glad that when darkness comes my way, I remember who watches over me.
Yes.
I remember whose hand I'm in. Don't get it twisted. Sometimes I feel like my work is in vain. Sometimes I feel like I'm tired of fighting this battle. Sometimes I feel like the sun will never shine again. Sometimes I feel like it's been too long, been too much, been too hard, been too deep. I want to quit. I want to take my ball and go home. I want to go somewhere and fight no more. And then I remember who brought me on my way.
That weeping may endure for the night,